Good morning, dear friends, and welcome to our online service. We at Bellville Presbyterian Church believe in spreading the word of God to those near and far. May you find upliftment in the message brought to you today by our Reverend John Comninos. In our reading last week, John brought the word to us from Luke chapter 1, verses 5 to 19. Here we learned about the barrenness of Elizabeth and Zechariah's almost disbelief when the angel Gabriel told him that Elizabeth would soon be with child and they must name him John. On Wednesday past, we had our service of thanksgiving and many testimonies of thankfulness were heard. Our hearts were not barren, but overflowed with thankfulness and testimonies of what the Lord did in the lives of our congregation. Therefore we can pray and say, Lord, we thank you that our spirits are not barren or empty, but overflowing with gratefulness and thanks. In John's message last Sunday, he taught us that when God speaks, we need to listen. When God speaks, we need to believe. When God speaks, we need to receive. Father, let us always receive with thankfulness what you have given us. I pray this in your glorious name. Amen.
Good morning. A call to worship comes from John chapter 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Let us worship together.
Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything lets me rest in the meadow and leads me to the quiet streams. He restores my soul and he leads me in the paths that are right.
Lord, you are my shepherd, you are my friend.
To follow my friend. Dear God, today we come to you to confess our many sins. We have done so much wrong, we can't even list it all. We confess that we have turned against you and gone on our own path. We also confess that we have done wrong in your eyes and not even thought about it. We are asking you for your forgiveness for all we have done wrong and all we still will do wrong. In your holy name, amen.
Good morning, BBC. Today's first reading comes from 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 1 to 10, Hannah's prayer. Then Hannah prayed. She said, "The Lord has filled my heart with joy. He has made me strong. I can laugh at my enemies. I'm so glad he saved me. There isn't anyone holy like the Lord. There isn't anyone except him. There isn't any rock like our God. Don't keep talking so proudly. Don't let your mouth say such proud things. The Lord is a God who knows everything. He judges everything people do. The bows of great heroes are broken, but those who trip and fall are made strong. Those who used to be full have to work for food, but those who used to be hungry aren't hungry anymore. The woman who couldn't have children has 7 of them now, but the woman who has had many children is sad now because hers have died. The Lord causes people to die. He also gives people life. He brings people down to the grave. He also brings people up from the death. The Lord makes people poor. He also makes people rich. He brings people down. He also lifts people up. He raises poor people from the trash pile. He lifts needy people out of the ashes. He lets them sit down, sits with the princes. He gives them places of honor. The foundation of the earth belongs to the Lord. On them he has set the world. He guards the path of his faithful servants, but evil people will lie silent in their dark graves. People don't win just because they are strong. Those who oppose the Lord will totally be destroyed. The Most High God will thunder from heaven. The Lord will judge the earth from one end to the other. He will give power to his king. He will give honor to his anointed one. This is the word of God. The second reading comes from Luke chapter 1, verse 46 to 55. Mary's song. Mary said, "My soul gives glory to the Lord. My spirit delights in God, my Savior. He has taken note of me, even though I am not considered important. From now on, all people will call me blessed. The Mighty One has done great things for me. His name is holy. He shows his mercy to those who have respect for him, from parent to child down through the years. He has done mighty things with his powerful arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their deepest thoughts. He has brought down rulers from the thrones, but he has lifted up people who are not considered important. He has filled with good things those who are hungry, but he has sent away those who are rich. He has helped the people of Israel who serve him. He has always remembered to be kind to Abraham and his children down through the years. He has done just as promised to our people of long ago." This is the word of God.
Today I would like to begin with a question from a song, then an analogy by Archbishop Desmond Tutu, and then a lyric from a song by Billie Eilish. I'll start with a question from a song. It's a song by Alex Clare, a kind of indie singer, and it's called Whispering. And he asks a question in this song. Let me read to you. "Whispering, whispering, 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 as I pass myself down to my knees. Whispering, 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 as I fall through the willow trees. And I said, who will care for the fallen? Who will care for the falling leaves? Whispering, 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 as I fall through the willow trees. And I said, who will care for the fallen? Who will care for the fallen?" And then an analogy from Archbishop Desmond Tutu. "If you are neutral in situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor. If an elephant has its foot on the tail of a mouse, and you say that you are neutral, the mouse will not appreciate your neutrality." And then there's a song by Billie Eilish, which is a play on the philosopher Descartes, who said, "I think, therefore I am." And this is the lyric of the one verse. "I'm not your friend or anything, damn. You think that you're the man. I think, therefore I am. I'm not your friend or anything, damn. You think that you're the man. I think, therefore I am." We are near the end of a full year, and we are preparing to celebrate Christmas. This season in the church, as we know, is called Advent, meaning the imminence of Christ, the coming or arrival. We are expecting the coming of Jesus to earth through the Bar Mudder of Mary, his mother, into the world. God becoming human, God becoming flesh. And we also await for Jesus to come into our lives. We take this not only as a symbolic welcoming of Jesus, but actually of us preparing our hearts and our minds to receive Jesus. Our scripture today comes from a passage that is familiar to many of us, from Luke chapter 1. It starts, "My soul," it's a song of Mary, and it starts, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour." It's one of the earliest songs in the New Testament, probably the first one on the Gospel Hit Parade. Now, for those of you who are too young to remember what that means, a hit parade, when I was a boy, I used to, on a Friday evening, listen to what they called the hit parade. It would be the top 20 or more songs. And it was presented by a very cool guy by the name of David Gresham. Nowadays, you call it hot tracks or charts or top 40. But this song is a song that Mary, the mother of Jesus, sings. Now, when the angel announced to Mary that she was to bear a child who would be Christ the Savior, she was also told that Elizabeth, also from her family, would bear a son, even though Elizabeth was, to use a euphemism, advanced in years. She was to give birth to a son whom we know grew up to be John the Baptist. But after the visit of the angel, Mary went to visit Elizabeth and Zechariah and in the hill country of Judea. And after they had exchanged greetings, Mary bursts into song. And we call this song the Magnificat, not because it was magnificent, but after the first few lines which begin in Latin, "Magnificat anima meo Dominum," my soul magnifies the Lord. And with this song, with this hymn, Mary praises God for choosing her to be the mother of this child in her Bar Mudder. And she praises God for remembering his promises. It is interesting that Mary's song, or psalm, is one of the few psalms in the New Testament. The song is based on another song in the Old Testament, the song of Hannah in 1 Samuel chapter 2. I'll just remind you of the story of Hannah and Elkanah. They were the parents of Samuel. Hannah was old. She was terribly upset that she was barren. She couldn't have children. So after a festival, she stays in the temple and she's weeping and she's praying for a child. She was so distraught that Eli, the priest, thought she might be drunk. She made known her prayer to God, and she promised that if God gave her a child, she would give that child to God. And her prayer is answered, not because of the bargain, but because of the grace of God. And she names him Samuel. And when she brought the child to the temple as a gift to God, she sang her own song. That story is so similar to Elizabeth and Zechariah, the parents of John the Baptist, that we might expect Elizabeth to sing a song, but Mary does. And it kind of doesn't really fit for Mary, a young virgin, to sing the song. An unwed mother is the one chosen by God to bear this special human being. God many times through the Old Testament gave children to old childless couples, Abraham and Sarah, Isaac, Manoah and his wife were given Samson, and Elkanah and Hannah, Samuel. Into this tradition comes John, and he is born. But now a song from this tradition is broken and it's sung by a young virgin, the tradition is interrupted. The old is new and the familiar strange, because God is doing a new thing and we need to feel it, we need to sense it, even in the context of the revelation of God through the scriptures. Had Elizabeth sung Hannah's song, it would have been said that God continues to be gracious to the barren as of old. However, when the Virgin Mary sings it, it must be said that God's grace is not as of old, but it is new, it is strange, it is surprising, it is beyond understanding. This child would not be like Isaac or Samson or Samuel. He would be someone even more extraordinary. And what does Mary sing? She begins with the words in the Greek, Isihimu, my soul. It's another way to refer to personal praise that comes from the depth of a person, inside a person. Its meaning in Greek is connected with the soul being the seat of feelings, desires, affections, aversions. It's the core of a person. So what she's saying is, out of the core of me comes this song to God. It parallels what is said in verse 47, Ipnevmamu, Ipsihimu, my soul, and Ipnevmamu is my spirit. And this shows that often there was no clear distinction between the psyche and the pneuma, the soul and the spirit. They used synonymously. So a song opens with joy and praise that God has favored whom she calls a humble servant of God. My soul glorifies, Isihimu glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. But she speaks about herself only in passing, indirectly. What she looks at and what she shows us is the very goodness of God. Now, to call God good in any time period is a subversive act. It is shocking. In the last few years, we've experienced terrible things, and we may forget them. Just a few months ago, we were still wearing masks. And how many hundreds of thousands of people have died on God's earth. And to call God good in the midst of that is a subversive act. I know that in the last year, there have been many traumas, many tragedies, many things that are difficult to face in the world and even in our individual lives. But we still call God good. And that is a subversive act. You will notice her emphasis is not entirely on spiritual things. She mentions God acting towards people on earth in their difficulties. The story of Christmas is not some esoteric spiritual story that is far above us and God becomes human. It is connected and bound to earth. And she ties here the threads of the coming of Jesus to all the acts of God in the past, in the present and the future. She speaks of God's work of blessing the oppressed, the poor, the hungry, and that finally God will bring down the proud and the rich and the oppressors, and how he will lift and exalt the disenfranchised, the disregarded and the dismissed. This is very important, because as we expect Jesus to come, we need to know what kind of Jesus is coming. Who is the Christ? And in Luke's Gospel, if you read the Gospel of Luke, you will see this pattern repeated. This is emphasized over and over again. Jesus is coming to do something to the poor and the hungry. He's come to bring down the proud and the rich, but he's come to be there for the disenfranchised, the marginalized. Now, the remarkable tone of the song is that it emphasizes that the justice that God will bring to pass is spoken of in the past tense. You'll notice it says, has shown strength, has scattered the proud, has put down the mighty, has exalted the lowly, has filled the hungry, and has sent the rich away empty. Why the past tense? According to the latest news reports, those things haven't happened yet, so why the past tense? Well, what Mary is doing is a faithful expression of trust in God. She speaks of the future with such trust that she describes it as already there. And of course, you must remember that this hope, this trust, is already in her belly. As the baby grows in the barmuda, she can probably touch her stomach and sense that this child is growing within her. And this child, Jesus, is about to be given birth and create what is our salvation. So she's saying has. It's a beautiful way of looking at hope, which is both something we don't have and something we do have. With hope, we always have the hope in us, but we're also moving towards it. It's not complete yet. So she says, God has, God has, God has, as she touches her stomach. A Christian does not live in the impossibilities of change and newness, the weakness of what he or she cannot do. The Christian lives always in the knowledge of what God can do, of what God has done. And you will notice how she juxtaposes in her praise the past and the future and the present. We live in the possibility of hope. So we see in the present tense, Mary lifts up the Lord. In the past tense, she praised her Savior. In the past tense, he saw her humble position. In the future, all generations shall praise her. So all praise, if you think about it, takes place juxtaposed between past, present, and future. Now, why is this so? Well, simply because God is past, present, and future. And when we come into the kingdom of Jesus, we are placed in a unique position to know a God who has worked in the past, is working in the future, and who will accomplish his purposes in the future. God is outside of time. And so when we worship him and pray to him, our prayers take on an eternal nature. They take on another dimension. To celebrate the future as a memory, to praise God for having already done what lies before us to do, this is the way of the people of God. And Mary is aware. She's aware that God is able and about to do something good. She's been touched by the Spirit, and she becomes aware that God's new thing will touch her, but go beyond her and touch the world. God's people parade before they march, like Jericho. History teaches us that God is at work and God will do what he said he will. And we are all a mixture of past, present, and future. And if we live without God, these are disconnected. But if we live in a knowledge of God's acting in history, all of these different parts become one in us. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So there's a cosmic coming together in what Mary sees. And we are given insight into this movement of God. She says, his mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones. He has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. The Bible is viewed essentially as a subversive text. in the sense that God always takes the side of the weak. Now, subversive means seeking or intending to subvert or change an established system or institution. Subversive literature is a literature which attempts to change things, troublemaking. It's insurrectionary, it agitates, it's revolutionary. And in these words, you will see that God is about to revolutionize the world. She's saying God has, and it's a movement from the past, and it's moving into the future. And of course, the cross is where it's going. It's not enough to proclaim that the Bible reveals a God who takes sides with the poor, the oppressed, and the marginalized, though. It's not enough to say that. We need to become that. We need to become that. What else is linking the past, the present, and the future? What else reaches from the past to the present and into the future? Well, of course, the child in her womb, the one we celebrate this Christmas, the one who became a human. He is the bridge between all the tenses. What kind of a child would Mary give birth to? In the end, this whole song is a birthing process, and we are pretty much in on the secret. We are being told what kind of child Mary would give birth to. Her song is actually about God bringing this to completion through this child. And remarkably, God did all these things to Mary through Jesus. Bishop Tutu, Archbishop Tutu, said, "If you are neutral in situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor. If an elephant has its foot on the tail of a mouse, and you say that you are neutral, the mouse will not appreciate your neutrality." God is not neutral. God will not look upon oppression and do nothing. So Mary's song tells us a few things about God. Number one, God is never neutral towards injustice. In this child growing in her, God is moving towards injustice and setting it right. Secondly, God is generous in God's love. It says he has performed mighty deeds with his arms. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. God is generous in his love. The generosity of God is growing inside of her. As God has become human and joined with her and will proceed from her and become a man whom we serve and love, and the one who would be crucified for all of the cosmos. Thirdly, God is proactive and hates grandiosity and pride. He will do something about those who act better than others. God hates that. It says in verse 52, he has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. Jesus will do that. He will do that in the way that he talks to the proud Pharisees who lift themselves and exalt themselves up above all the simple people, the so-called sinners. And what God does in the cross is he takes down the picture of the ambitious people who pretend that they know everything about God and are holier than thou. And he lifts up the humble, the woman caught in adultery, the Samaritan woman who had many husbands, the blind man who people thought was such a terrible sinner. So that's why he had been made blind by God. Jesus will invert that. He will change it all around. Fourthly, God is in the business of overturning the social order. She says, he has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has filled the hungry with good things. God is going to change the fact that there are people who are hungry that are not getting food. He's bringing Jesus to do that. And fifthly, God is here for the poor. God is here for the poor. Blessed are the poor in spirit, is what Matthew says. But in Luke's gospel, in the Beatitude, it says, blessed are the poor. Blessed are the poor. and all because of Jesus. All because of Jesus. I remember reading once in a letter by Fyodor Dostoevsky about his love for Jesus. He says, there is nothing more beautiful, more profound, more sympathetic, more reasonable, more courageous, and more perfect than Christ. And not only is there nothing, but I tell myself in jealous love that never could there be. Jesus will come in his beauty to bring about a new order. But I want to close with one more thing. Mary's song doesn't only tell us what God is doing, but it also tells us a few things about us as Christians. Number one, Christians are never neutral towards injustice. If we are neutral towards injustice, we are not being Christ to the world. Secondly, Christians are generous in their love. Christians act like God by bringing generosity, grace to people, the gift of love, not only by the words we speak or by something patronizing, but actually in action. Thirdly, Christians are proactive and hate grandiosity and pride. Christians hate grandiosity and pride. Christians do not glory in people exalting themselves above those who are lower. They stoop down like Jesus and are one with the oppressed. Christians are in the business of overturning the social order. That's our job. But we don't overturn the social order by creating a new political party. What we do is we act differently to the world. We act differently to people who grab material possessions, people who grab to hold. We give as God gave. And then fifthly, Christians are here for the poor. When we follow Jesus, we're part of a process where we give birth to Jesus and where the child is born in us by the Holy Spirit. And then our lives are to reflect that, the beauty of that. I close with Romans chapter 8, verse 38. I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, or earth heavenly rulers, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for the beauty of Jesus, for the beauty of the song that reflects what you are doing. Help us to continue to be subversive in the way that we move differently to the way the world does, the world order does. Help us to bring Christ, to birth Christ, and bring Christ to the poor, the marginalized, to establish your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
Thank you. to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us. To him be glory in the Church and in Jesus Christ, through all generations, for ever and ever. Amen.